Hello everyone, I wanted to do a recording to talk about Guild Wars 2 as it is coming to Steam. Because it is coming to Steam, there is a chance that people will be trying Guild Wars 2 for their first time, and I think that's perfectly fine. It may be an old game, but it's still a game worth playing if there is nothing else better to do, which, in the current state of things, is probably going to happen. Unfortunately, a lot of games have been pushed back, or won't see full release for some time or something. It's kind of a weird year or two for video games. But moving on. So I want to do my best to give you as much information as possible to work with, and I will start with the game itself. So you can play the game itself for free if you really want to. If you do play for free, you'll get access to the base game, but anything that came after the base game, you're going to have to pay for in terms of the expansions. So I would recommend that you try it first, and then if you think that you like it, then go ahead and get the expansions. The base game will give you 2 character slots, but once you buy the expansions, you gain 3, giving you 5 in total. You'll have more than enough character slots to do whatever you need to for this game, and I'll go over that a little bit. But for now, I'm just going to go over the basics of what you can expect with this. Now, let me type over. Okay. Guild Wars 2 has been, for the longest time, really friendly to Linux. Between that and Path of Exile, they're the 2 friendliest online games for Linux right now. For Guild Wars, though, at least up until this announcement of Steam, it's been playable through Lutris. Lutris isn't exactly easy to use, though. That means that Steam will make this a lot easier because it uses Proton. Proton is something that Steam designed for Linux compatibility. It's really easy to set up. You go into your Steam settings, you flip on the Proton option, and you click the latest Proton version, and Steam will take care of the rest from there. That is quite literally the process. It's very simple. If you do want to play this in Path of Exile on Linux, you can totally do that. But moving back to more stuff. Okay, if you're new or returning to Guild Wars 2, there are a couple of websites that you should be aware of. I haven't pulled them all up. I've only pulled up the most important ones. Obviously, the wiki is going to be very, very important. This is a great source of information. It's up to date. You shouldn't have much of an issue getting all the information you need from here. The only things that you probably won't be able to find on the Guild Wars wiki is specific step-by-step guides on how to find certain things on the map. Because there are certain things on the map that will be quite annoying to find. You'll have to resort to YouTube videos for those. The wiki won't help you there. But the wiki can take care of a lot of things like where does this item come from, how do you craft this, etc. The other good website to be aware of is this one. This is the build calculator that I've been using for my Guild Wars theories. And you can use it for figuring out your builds as well. Guild Wars is thankfully a lot simpler than Path of Exile, so you should be able to create your own custom character and still be relatively functional with in-game content. Keyword should be. It just depends on the build and a couple other things. But either way, you can go here to figure out your builds and do things the way you want to. I'll go over these builds that I have pulled up here in a bit, but right now, basic information. Let's see. Okay, next thing I want to cover is the crafting. Now, there are going to be tons of guides out there, and that's going to be included on the other websites that I meant to pull up, but didn't get to. I don't agree with a lot of the crafting guides out there, so let me just go ahead and give you a quick thing to follow with crafting. Crafting isn't exactly required in this game. You can always buy whatever you need to, assuming you have enough money to do it. But if you do want to craft your own stuff, then you're going to have a very long road ahead of you, because crafting in this game does take quite a while on some professions. That said, what I would recommend doing is, because you do come across a lot of materials as you're leveling, I would recommend just using the materials you come across, and then whatever you can't do, you can buy or whatever. To do that, I would start with doing discovery. When you open your crafting tab, or I should say crafting station, you'll notice that there are several tabs on the left-hand side of the crafting station. One of them is discovery. Discovery nets you so much experience for your crafting profession. I would do that as much as possible until it no longer becomes an option. Once you've gone through all of your discovery, then start crafting stuff normally to finish out the rest of whatever level you're shooting for. That is how I would handle crafting, or recommend how to handle it to other players. I don't agree with the guides that say to buy your stuff, because that's just going to take too much money, and yeah, it's just a nightmare doing the whole purchase method. You save a lot of money just using the resources that you have available to you, so I would do that. Okay, now to go over the last basic, and that's how the class system is handled. In Guild Wars 2, in comparison to other MMOs, nothing is straightforward. You can customize things to a certain degree. So let me show you that. For those who are returning or new, the game runs on specialization. So you pick a class, but then you can modify said class to your specific playstyle. So you pick, say, Guardian, which is kind of a Paladin, Warrior, or one of the other base classes. From there, you take the specialties that best fit you. You have your base specializations, and then you have your elite specializations. Each class has 3 elite specializations at this time. For Guardian, that's going to be Willbender, Firebrand, and the other one I forgot. Oh, Dragon Hunter, yeah. So, that's kind of to show you where things go with the class system. As part of this whole class thing, I will point out that this game has a very simple set of numbers. You have your power, critical chance, condition damage. Condition damage has to do with dots. Concentration has to do with boon duration, so buffs is another way of simplifying that. Critical damage. I mean, everything here is pretty straightforward in the character sheet when you're looking at the calculator and in game, so I wouldn't worry about that too much. Okay, with the basics out of the way, now I want to go ahead and kind of give you a little bit of an advanced demonstration, I guess you can say, using some theories that I conjured up. Okay, so a while back, I did a recording when End of Dragons was new. End of Dragons is the most recent expansion to Guild Wars 2. I did a theory video because I disagreed with a lot of the things that were being said in regards to certain new professions and things of that nature. I have since refined these theories and have came up with more theories for testing, but for now, I'll just show you the theories as they are. They're not complete builds, but it should give you some idea of what you're up against. So, Willbender, my theory was that at first that virtues would be a good thing for it, but then I realized even with virtues, your cooldowns are still too high on the virtues, so then I shifted to Zeal and Radiance because I was like, well, you need something to help you through combat when your virtues are on cooldown, and that actually seems to be working much better because the build relies on brute force power and some condition damage, i.e. dots. In this case, burning, and that's the type of dot this build runs. So you'll notice that my power rating is 2105, which is much higher than any other Guardian or Willbender build that I've been able to locate. If I missed one, you're more than welcome to let me know, though. But you'll notice all the other stuff is pretty high. The overall defense rating, health, and other things. It's just precision, which is the critical chance rating, that's pretty low. But I think it makes up for it with the boons, aka buffs. So let's look over this. So one thing I detected with Radiance was the Signets of Power thing. It's the same thing I did with the other theory builds I showed. Is that you get this, which does break stun, cause burning, and you gain 12% damage reduction even when it's on cooldown because of the Radiance passive. So you need things to be burning to trigger your Radiance passive, which I'll show you right now. It's this one right here. Yes, it has a 10-second cooldown, I know, but still, it's there. And then the critical strikes is because of that over there. So, anyways, that's one way to do it. Now, as a backup, I have Rolling Light on this particular theory build because I detected that if I'm going to use the Signet for burning everything and getting that all started, then I need something to break stun should it happen after using the Signet, so that's why Rolling Light's there. And because burning's the thing, or at least a core of the build, then I did this as well. And then finally over here I did this because, again, you need critical strikes to trigger everything, so pretty much straightforward here. Oh, and over here is another Signet, because this one has a 4-second interval with the Signet power passive. So it's 4 seconds, it's clearing condition, and it does that all the time, even if it's on cooldown. So yes, I did that for a very good reason. The Greatsword is there because it's the highest damage I'm able to achieve in the calculator using Willbender. But also because Greatsword does have a lot of great abilities in multiple situations. For equipment, you'll notice that everything here is going to be Celestial. Ascendant, of course, because the calculator goes by Ascendant. You can switch it to Exotic if you want to see the stats for Exotic, but I leave it at the default setting, which is Ascendant. But Superior Rune of Divinity, this is what I'm using as the rune set, and that's just because it's plus all stats, which is exactly what I need for this particular build, given that it's doing a lot of things. As for the infusions, they are precise, because again, my precision's pretty low, and I need that to trigger the fires. Over here is Opal Orbs. I know that every build uses the signets or runes or whatever they're called, but I don't agree with that because I think that raw stats are better. And anyways, like I said, I need precision to trigger all the fires. So there's that. And there you have it. That's pretty much the build in as short of a summary as I can give you. Let me show you the other build theory for you. My other build theory is Deadeye, and this one is a little bit more precise in terms of how it's handled, but you'll notice that just like the Willbender build, it is using its Signets of Power passive, and that's why it has this over here, Assassin Signet. Unfortunately, like the Willbender though, these Signets passives are not active when they're on cooldown. So this is just going to hang out over there to give you power, which is quite a bit, all things considered. It's 180 additional power, and I guess if an emergency calls for it, you can burst it to 540. And of course, I have two stun breaks over here, because same theory or concept as the Willbender build. If the Deadeye has to use Roll for Initiative to get initiative, then it can do that. Although I don't think it will have to do that, and I'll show you why in a minute. But for right now, it has this as backup for the other break stun in case that you have to use Roll for Initiative on the initiative gain. And just like the other build, it's using the Signet, it causes healing. But that's because this signet is giving you a heal on hits. So it's actually very good as a passive when combined with everything else. And I'll talk about healing power here in just a minute, but let's get through this. So obviously using rifles here, because rifles do a lot of damage if you're kneeled. But if you're not kneeled, then dual pistols for ranged damage will do a lot more on Deadeye than rifle will. So keep that in mind when going forward with this. But for now, we're just doing a look at the rifle build. You'll notice that these are the specializations here. It is critical strikes and acrobatics. And there's a very good reason for that. You'll notice that I went premeditation instead of silent scope. And I have a very good reason for doing this. Yes, the build is using a rifle, but if the build has to resort to pistols at any given point, then it can transfer over without any thought. But there's another reason to this. It's because if you look, premeditation says that you do 1% more damage per boon. Now, if you look over here, I took this, Maleficent 7. So this is going to give you a whole bunch of boons when you reach your maximum malice stack. That's the thing over here. And yeah, that's something that you'll be doing anyways. Because what you want to do is mark the target before lining it up. So that's what this is about. That's the Deadeye specialization, by the way. You mark the target before shooting them. But anyways. So yes, you should have this triggering premeditation at any given point. You also have other things in here. Let me see, where is it? Yeah, there it is. So here's another way to trigger premeditation. And where's the other one? It is right here, question mark? Yeah, it's this line right here. It's gaining swiftness and vigor for doing dodges and things of that nature. That's another way to trigger your premeditation. But anyways, yeah, so you can see that the build is meant to be versatile. It's not specific to rifles. It's really there to adapt to the situation as needed. That's essentially what's going on here. But yes, the build should be able to work with pistols, rifles, and also sword and dagger, because I did take, which one is it? It's this one over here, yeah. Now, you'll notice Swindler's Emporium is plus 120 power when you don't have your sword and dagger on, but it's another 120 when it is. So actually, this is providing 120 power even if you don't have your sword and dagger equipped. So that's actually why this particular Deadeye build is, well, at least part of why this protector Deadeye build has got so much power to it. But let's look at equipment now. So just like the Willbender Theory build, I am using orbs instead of the runes or signets, whatever they're called. So I did recognize that at least survivability was the problem here. So while you could change this build around to do more power, I don't think that it's really worth it considering you're already at 2400. You can go all the way out to 2700 with this build if you switch things around, but I also don't think it's worth it. You need survivability, so this is about as balanced as I can make the build. But anyways, so you can see that I took those orbs, which is different than the Willbender build, because these are Azurite, and these ones are Opal. For equipment, you'll notice that nearly everything is the new prefix from End of Dragons, which is the Dragon's prefix. It has a very high ferocity rating. That's why I picked it, because we are going for critical strikes. And then on the back and jewelry, that's all assassins, because precision and more ferocity. So you'll notice I'm kicking out 70% chance to critical on the calculator, and a 236.53% critical damage. So this build can actually hit really hard while still maintaining some survivability. Because you'll notice its overall defense rating is 2272, which is a little above baseline. It's not good, but it's certainly above baseline. As far as the runes, superior rune of the Traveler. This is to give it even more versatility. You'll notice that because boons are a part of its core theory, this does give it more boon duration, but also movement speed. Given now that there are multiple specializations or classes that move really quick, i.e. Willbender, you need to be able to keep your distance, and you're not going to be able to keep your distance if you can't outrun or keep pace with the builds that have the ability to run really fast. So that should be able to fix the situation. The plus all to all stats is very nice as well. For the infusions, they're all resilient because you need the toughness to kind of balance things out in terms of your defenses. You'll notice that you have 1401 vitality just by wielding dragons. So toughness is the one that's kind of slacking, and that's where we're going to make up for things. So yeah, that's another difference. This is resilience, infusions, and this is precision. So there you have it. There's my two theory builds, so you can kind of get some idea of how things connect and how you can do the builds yourself. I will end this recording on one final note regarding the classes. In Guild Wars 2, they make it very easy to get a second character to max level near instantly. So in this particular game, it's not required, but it's certainly easier, I guess you can say, to have two characters, one specific to PvP and one specific to the other functions of the game. So you actually could run both of these theory builds if you wanted to. I would recommend using Willbender specific for PvP because of how tough it is and because of how quick it is to get out of danger. Some of your PvP maps are extremely close quartered, so it would be very difficult to run a Deadeye even with dual pistols or rifle. I think that Deadeye would be better off doing World v. World or PvE. I think those are the two things that it would do best with. But that's all I have. Thanks for listening. Oh, and maybe see you in Guild Wars 2.